Good morning, Keel Street. It is good to be with you. Grant is enjoying some vacation time. I haven't heard a lot from him, but that's probably for the best because it means he's able to disconnect a little bit. Let's open by reading a passage from 1 Timothy. If anyone teaches false doctrines and does not agree to the sound instruction of our Lord Jesus Christ and to godly teaching, he is conceited and understands nothing. He has an unhealthy interest in controversies and quarrels about words that result in envy, strife, malicious talk, evil suspicions, and constant friction between men of corrupt mind who have been robbed of the truth and who think that godliness is a means to financial gain. But godliness with contentment is great gain. For we brought nothing into the world, and we can take nothing out of it. But if we have food and clothing, we will be content with that. People who want to get rich fall into temptation at a trap and into many foolish and harmful desires that plunge men into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. Some people, eager for money, have wandered from the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs. But you, man of God, flee from all this and pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, endurance, and gentleness. Fight the good fight of the faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called when you made your good confession in the presence of many witnesses. In the sight of God who gives life to everything, and of Christ Jesus, who while testifying before Pontius Pilate made the good confession, I charge you to keep this command without spot or blame until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ, which God will bring about in his own time. God, the blessed and only ruler, the King of kings and Lord of lords, who alone is immortal and who lives in unapproachable light, whom no one has seen or can see, to him be honor and might forever. Amen. Let us adore that God this morning.
Is the Lord.
we do come before you, asking that the curtain of heaven be drawn back, that we might see as John did that throne room where you could be seen on the throne from which you rule. And before you, the Lamb, looking as though it had been slain. The one who is worthy. Worthy. The one for whom the new song was sung. Because he is worthy. Because you, Father, are worthy. Because you have created all things. And all things are for and by and from you. And yet your creation was by, through, and for the Son, Jesus. And we can't understand a relationship like that, where two are one and share one spirit. But you are worthy. You are worthy of praise. You made this world, this universe, and when we rebelled, you did not abandon us, but came in person to rescue us. Lord, we ask that you would gather us before you in awe and worship for all you have done. Amen. And yes, he is faithful and strong. He will keep his promise to save all who come to him.
Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For he is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise. Mighty hand and an outstretched arm. His love endures forever. Been reborn, his love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Forever God is faithful, forever God is strong.
Endures forever actually comes from a psalm where every other line is the audience repeating his love endures forever. And the Hebrew word for love there, chesed, it's not a romantic love, it's not necessarily an affectionate love, although what it is is a covenant love. In other words, we talk about God being faithful. It's being faithful because he made a covenant with us, a peace treaty, if you will. And that theme pervades much of the Old Testament. It's part of the nature of the relationship we have. And in a covenant, even a political covenant, back in the days of people like Abraham, was described in terms of love. The king would love his vassal, and the vassal would love the king. They would often use terms like parent and child to refer to one another in the covenant. It is this kind of covenant love where it is bound by treaty. And God is going to be faithful to that treaty because it is his nature to be faithful, to keep his promises. It is also like marriage, right? Where it is a covenant between people to put the other's best interests first. And this kind of love from God endures forever. So let's respond to that covenant love with worship. Lovely, wonderful God invites us to share with him our feelings, our hopes, our desires, our needs, because he has such grace for us. He knows us all the way to the bottom of our hearts. And I pray that it would become more and more your experience that within this community of believers, you are known And that you never have to feel like you can't, that you have to hold back something of yourself or your secrets. You can be loved here because God already knows, already loves, is already to forgive. It is unbelievable to be, to receive that kind of grace. Let's praise Him for it. We know that it's not like you belong to us because we made you or we control you, but you show us such grace. You care so much that the things we talk to you about matter to you too, because you know us. You know every hair on our head. Each one of us was individually designed by you. And Lord, I can't get my head around that some days. And yet this is the love to which you are faithful. not to the polished me that I want people to see and like, but the real me. And Lord, I ask that you would give your people a greater sense today of how amazing that grace is. How high and wide and long and deep is the love of Christ. How enduring is the love of Christ. Lord, we're told by scientists that the universe could last for billions more years before it runs out of energy. But what we know from your word is that your love will still never run out. Never. Because it comes from you who are infinite. And we thank you for that. It is the only thing that we have to hold on to. Lord, grace makes our hearts fear because we realize that we can't fix the situation we've put ourselves in. But grace relieves our fears by reminding us that you are carrying us. That your grace is sufficient. You cover our guilt. You cover our shame. You take away all the things that are wrong. You are big enough to forgive the worst we have done. And Lord, as a country, we are having to come face to face with some of the worst we have done. Face to face with our need to repent for how our country has treated those who are a part of it. Lord, injustices have been perpetrated over and over. In fact, Lord, we are still harming people every day, and our government will simply not listen to any who would speak up for those who are harmed. And our God, we repent. And we pray that our country would and start treating people with justice. Your kind of justice, Lord, that looks out for all who are weaker, who can't take care of themselves, who can't speak for themselves. Lord, a justice that does not shout down those who need to be heard, but instead hears out with that grace and patience. So, Lord, we do cry out to you for our political and community leaders, that you would prod them to do what is true justice and not just make political promises. Lord, we ask for justice. We ask that you, as our King, would move Canada's political leaders to do justice and love mercy. And Lord, if we dare to ask this much, that they would walk humbly with you. We ask also for the leaders of our congregation. We're kind of at a critical moment where we're becoming a new legal entity. And Lord, as we look back over this past year, we realize that we haven't done as well as we should have at being a community with one another. And we ask that you would guide us into doing better at taking care of one another, because we know that's critically important to you. That was the command you gave us, that we love one another just as you loved us. Give us power to do that, Lord. And I pray that you would deliver us from whatever bad habits we have that cause that to be a problem, whether that's bitterness or malice or envy or spite or gossip or self-centeredness, our own blinders, Lord, Help us to see past, because you want us to be Babeloff, the one family of people from every tribe and language and people and nation. And Lord, there is more than language and culture that divide us. And we ask that you would give us power to be one. And Lord, we ask that you would place your power on all those who are out inviting people to be part of that community. Lord, we were saddened to hear this week that one of the evangelists in Laos had to sign a statement saying that she would not evangelize or preach or worship in the name of Jesus Christ. And she signed it so that she would be released from the police custody. Lord, we ask that you would forgive her and rally around her to give her courage. Lord, we ask that you would draw her nearer to you, and that she would find more of that amazing grace in you. Lord, we ask that your power would be upon those who are out there speaking and who are out there caring for the poor. We ask that you would provide, because, Lord, you are our provider. Lord, as Rico comes and to give our pastoral prayer and to lead us from your word, we ask that you would be upon him by your Spirit to help him to understand your word clearly, proclaim it clearly and boldly as he should. And, Lord, I pray that you would move us to respond to your word. Lord, we ask that you would be with Grant as he is away to strengthen and refresh and encourage him and inspire him, Lord, as I know he's already getting excited about the messages he that you have for him to present as we finish 2 Corinthians and move on. And I pray, Lord, that you would move in him powerfully to open the word to us with all skill and wisdom and compassion. Lord, we ask these things in the name of Jesus.
Good morning, church. Welcome to our service this morning, and I would like first of all to thank our worship team in behalf of Bill and Sister Mary and all the members of the praise team. You are doing a fine job, great job in the midst of this pandemic and up to last year, up to this time. We can imagine that this is now, we are heading to the second year of this worldwide pandemic, and still we are waiting for that day that all of us as a church will gather here in our building once again. Before I would like to give you the message that was Grant gave it to me as to conclude the second letter of Apostle Paul to the Corinthians as the concluding remarks and message of this series, I would like to pray for, first of all, to all of our brothers and sisters in this pastoral prayer. And let's bow our head before we start our message this morning. And we will pray all of our brothers and sisters who need prayers and encouragement at this time. Let's bow our head and let's pray. Our Father in heaven, you are so great that you gave us another chance, an opportunity to be with you, Lord, in every Lord's day of our lives. Lord, we acknowledge that you are our God, our Lord and Savior, because you put us in this situations that no one can imagine, that one day we will all survive with this worldwide pandemic, that one day we will see each other again. And I pray, Lord, as a member of this congregation here at Kill Street, that we pray all our brothers and sisters who are having problems in their lives presently, that if they have sickness in their bodies and they are struggling with their jobs, finding a new one because of this crisis that we are facing in this country and around the world. Father, gave them encouragement and hope that one day they will find rest and comfort that comes from you. Lord, we also pray around the churches here in Greater Toronto area, that as we experience the same thing, they are also experiencing the same situation of this pandemic, that we pray for the propagation of your gospel, that still we want to see that your word will be preached in the congregation every Lord's Day. Father, bless all our pastors and ministers, leaders, teachers, who are always sharing the good news of salvation to the people who are watching in the social media. Give them also hope, Lord, that in spite of this situation that we have, that, Lord, give us peace and your grace and your love and your guidance to each one of us. We pray that one day we will see each other again. We will hug each other again, and we will see them face to face. Oh Lord Jesus, don't let the pulpit call me to the sermon, and let the sermon call me to the pulpit. I want to preach under the divine anointing of the Holy Spirit. And Lord God, strip me of all pride, all cleverness, all showmanship and salesmanship. Deliver me from reliance on education, academics, personality, and celestial cliches. Let me speak with the humility of Moses, the wisdom of Paul, the power of Peter, and the authority of Christ, our Lord and Savior. Make my preaching today clear, not clever, passionate, not pitiful, and not usual. May it comfort the disturb the comfortable, warn the sinner, mature the saints, give hope to the discouraged, and ready for heaven the whole audience. Here I am, Lord. I am your vessel. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Welcome, brothers and sisters, for this last series of Grant's message, Messy Faith. And I want to conclude this on chapter 13, on his second epistle of Paul to the Corinthians, chapter 13, verses 11 to 13. And I would like to read it to you, those following verses. Now, Apostle Paul said to the Christians in Corinthians, in Corinth, brothers and sisters, be filled with joy. Try to make everything right. Do what I have asked you to do. Agree with each other and live in peace. Then the God of love and peace will be with you. Give each other the special greeting of God's people. All of God's holy people here send you their greetings. I pray that you will enjoy the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. Sometimes it's hard to say goodbye. In the case of Apostle Paul, he had been to the city of Corinth for a while, and he wrote two letters with them. If you wrote a letter or more than one to a specific location like the city of Corinth, you already established your relationship with them, and you treated them like a special person, special people, and not more than friends. Apostle Paul, when he wrote this last letter to them, he already established his personal relationship with them, individually and corporately. Multitudes of people. different kinds of doctrine of people, Greeks. Maybe there are Jewish people in the city of Corinth. Who knows? Whether it is a simple goodbye to a friend before vacation or farewell to a co-worker leaving for a new job, goodbyes aren't easy. Sometimes finding the right words to send someone off can be tricky. Saying goodbye to someone you love is heartbreaking, like Apostle Paul to the Corinthians. And often, it's difficult to find the right words to wish them farewell. I would like to give it to you five individuals who shared their words about saying goodbye. First of them, her name is Moira Rogers. She said, "The two hardest things to say in life is hello for the first time. When you meet someone, you say hi, hello, and goodbye for the last." That's what she said. The second one, the person named Rumi said, "Goodbyes are only for those who love with their eyes. Because for those who love their heart and soul, there is no such thing as separation." The third person said, her name is Kiera Cash, "You have changed me forever, and I'll never forget you." Those are very emotional words, you know, coming from other person. The fourth one, named Kiera Cash, Nicholas Sparks. He said, "The reason it hurts so much to separate is because our souls are connected." He also said, "This is not a goodbye, my darling. This is a thank you." Right? Lastly, a person named Tara Pratchett said, "No more words. We know them all. All the words that should not be said, but you have made my world more perfect." How the word goodbye is very, I would say, it's not an easy to say. Once you establish a relationship to someone, sometimes saying goodbye is not easy. Let's go to verse 11, and I would like to give you, Rani, next slide, please. I want to give you Apostle Paul's final challenge. And he said to the Christians in Corinth, "Now, brothers and sisters, we must be filled with joy." He said to them, "Rejoice, brothers and sisters. Strive for full restoration." Here, Apostle Paul say these words in a different way as their apostle. And it's hard for Apostle Paul to lead them permanently so that Paul can move on going to the different city of the Roman Empire. The word brothers in Greek is adelphoi. It is used here as a generic reference to both men and women. As Christians, the men and women of the Corinthian church are members of God's family and thus brothers and sisters in Christ. So Paul also speaks of the Corinthians as brothers in the first two sections of the letter, where he was primarily addressing those who were repentant. However, Paul does not address those who are rebellious as brothers. Now, in closing the letter, Paul again uses this loving familial expression to address the entire church at Corinth, which is an indication, no doubt, of his hope that they truly will be brothers and sisters in Christ as a result of the right response to his letter. Apostle Paul also summarizes the central conclusions of this second letter with five commands, with the first three commands focusing on the Corinthians' relationship with Apostle Paul as their apostle. The last two focusing on their life together as brothers and sisters in Christ and as a family of believers reconciled to each other and to God, their Father. We must be filled with joy in the time of this worldwide pandemic. Some people may be asked, how can you accept or experience joy in this kind of situation that we have right now or in our present time? How can you say to me that be joyful? Where is the joy? You know, I cannot even go outside in the streets without a mask. And now the weather here in Toronto right now is what? 30 degrees, 31 degrees? Hot, hot, hot. And now people wants to go out. They want to walk. They want to do cycling, anything they want. But their action was limited. People may question them, why are you not wearing a mask? How can you live normally in this kind of situation? That's it. The difficulties we face right now will not last forever. And they will not have the last word. That doesn't mean we should never be sad or angry or worried or disappointed. It will not last forever. It is not stronger that which will bring us great joy. So, Apostle Paul said to the Corinthians, keep the faith, the hope, and the confidence that ultimately it will be okay in God's time. God has it all in His hands. So even though there are genuinely difficult parts of our lives, still allow ourselves to be filled with joy. Allow the good in our lives to fill us with joy. Allow the knowledge that there will be good again, and there will be very good in the end, bring joy into our lives. The difficulties of this life we have during the pandemic, this worldwide pandemic, are not permanent in this world. That one day, this will be disappear. One day. But the question is, when? That is the most important question people ask. When? The answer in that question is only God knows when it will stop. But put our trust in the Lord that one day this things will be over one day. The truth is that there really is a good in our lives right now, even in the middle of difficulties and hardships. Apostle Paul mentioned it in his second letter here. He lists some things that are cause for joy, and all of the ones Paul mentions are based on God. The God whom we experience in different ways at different time in our lives. This triune God and what He is and does is the reason why Apostle Paul can say, rejoice. He is a God of peace and love. God has made peace with us. God is at peace with us that He wants to give us peace and loves us. He will be with us always and forever. In Jesus Christ, God meets us with His loving grace. He gave Himself for us so that He could forgive and accept us. In that, He showed the depths of His love, the love of a father of His children. And in the Holy Spirit, He grants and establishes, maintains and builds relationships and fellowships. The question is like, what kind of fellowship is this one Paul wants us to achieve or to receive? This is what the fellowship between the triune God and us. And the fellowship between each other. So that is the triune God interacting with us in different ways. Dealing with us in love, judging us according to His grace, establishing fellowships with and among us. Let accept that, enjoy it, and let it give us joy. Second, Ronnie, second slides, please. We must try to make everything right. Oh, I'm sorry, you're right, Ronnie. Encourage one another. So this is what Apostle Paul wants to say to the Corinthians, to the Corinthians Christians. They said, let's try, you know, to make everything right. How to make everything right about the present situation? In Apostle Paul's time, the Corinthian church is a troubled church. There are so many issues in that church. Incest, divisions, gossiping. There are so many problems in the church. And how are you going to make everything right? Through encouraging one another. This is what Apostle Paul said. Encourage one another. Giving grace with your words. In spite of all of these things happening inside the church. So if you are a member of this church at Corinth, you will say to yourselves, it's enough. I'm out of here. But Apostle Paul said, stay and pray and encourage one another. Hebrews chapter 3, verse 13 said, but encourage each other daily. This is what the writer of the Hebrews said, while it is still called today, so that none of you is hardened by sin's deceptions. So encouragement is so important to the church. God doesn't merely recommend it. God explicitly commands it. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 18, and chapter 5, verse 11. Apostle Paul said to the Thessalonians, Thessalonica, therefore, encourage one another with these words, brothers and sisters. Therefore, encourage one another and build each other up as you are already doing. Why we need encouragement? We need encouragement. God commanded that his people encourage each other because God knows we need it. So Apostle Paul helped us, and he gave us a model, six important principles to help us encourage one another or encourage others. First, begin with positive statements. People who know we will speak kindly to them will be happy to work with us. Second, develop expectations of others with consideration for their skills, maturity, and experience. People will reject or fail to meet expectations that do not fit them. Third, be patient with distracted or slow learners. There are so many people, or maybe even Christians, that need encouragement. I remember yesterday when we are talking in our nursing station, in my workplace, this woman, I worked with him for so many years. I've been working in my job now, it's now 15 years now, this year. And when I first worked in my workplace, I saw her already. So maybe she's working more than years that I worked there. She told me before lunch, because I usually, we are waiting to get the food from the servery to give it to the residents that we are looking for, we are taking care of. So we have 15 minutes to prepare, and all of them are waiting already in the dining area. So I play the piano. We have a piano there in front of the TV, beside or close to the dining area. So I play one song, and everybody's listening because they didn't hear anyone playing the piano because of the pandemic. No one is allowed to come to the building to entertain the residents. So I play one song. And then everybody is looking, who's that person who played there? So they know it's me. So after I play that one song, the nurse told me, I wish I could play the way you play the piano. And I told her, Playing piano is like a building a house. You cannot play the instrument one time. It's like building a house, step by step. It took me 5 years, full time, before I played the instrument. After 2 years, that's the time I start playing the piano. From scratch. No experience at all, way back in 1984. I went to Bible college to study music and theology without even knowing about these things. No experience, no idea about this instrument. But by God's grace, because I want to learn, I want to study about these things, and God put that ability and wisdom to my brain. And until this day, I still have it. Everywhere I go, if I saw there is a piano there and no one, and then I play. And I play the Christian music also, so that people will think about the God's love to them. And she told me, I wish my daughter also can play the way you play. I said, encourage her. Don't give up. But sometimes we need to encourage and we need to boost them or give them supplement, you know, as we give our resident supplement. If they don't want to eat, give them supplement so that they can still have strength. That idea is also same to each one of us. People, sometimes you have to push sometimes to make initiatives of their lives. Sometimes they need encouragement. If no one is doing encouragement and some giving them advices, they will not develop their skills. So be patient with distracted or slow learners. Fourth, monitor your expectations of others. Changing circumstances sometimes require revise or reduce expectations. Fifth, clarify your expectations with others. People are not likely to hit a target that no one has identified. Sixth, and with a statement of gratitude, the most important thing. People love to be thanked for a job well done. So, Sister Mary, Bill, and the rest of the worship team, you've been doing this almost, you know, this is now the second year that you've been doing this nonstop every Sunday. We are watching from home since the beginning of this pandemic. You deserve a pat in the back, you know, in the shoulder, you know, all of you. Because no one can sacrifice to come here every Sunday to do this wonderful job, a wonderful ministry of praising the Lord, singing godly songs, and encourage our brothers and sisters who are listening in their homes through social media. Not a lot of people can do this, you know. They need breaks, you know. But you guys are here, committing your lives to this kind of ministry. So the Lord will not forget what you do in the church. You are setting an example to keep going, you know, to move forward, you know. I also encourage with Bill, honestly. Bill didn't ask me, you know, about every time I see Bill standing here, you know, leading the worship service, I always think about his situation. I don't know if Bill found a new job, but God is still taking care of him. And we know that before the pandemic, we know that Bill worked in a good company, you know? And now look what happened to a lot of people. They lost their job because of the pandemic. But God is good. God is good. I believe that God will give us things that we don't expect. And I believe that God will taking care of each one who believes Him. In John chapter 16, verse 33, Jesus said to His disciples, "In this world," He said to them, "you will have trouble. But take heart. I have overcome the world." We live in a broken world where everything calls us together selfishness and despair. Honestly, sin steals joy. That's the truth. If you commit sin to the Lord and to God, the devil will steal your joy in your hearts. Sometimes our bodies break down. Working two jobs, especially in my job, a lot of my coworkers working two jobs, days and go to the other location evenings. Sometimes they sleep 3 hours, 4 hours. For me, it's not enough. I cannot do that. Sometimes bodies can break down. Sometimes our plans falter. We have so many plans before the pandemic. I want to do this. I want to do that. But what happened after? All of these plans didn't work. And nobody can go out and go to different countries they want to go because of these restrictions. Sometimes our dreams die. Said, forget it. I think I cannot take my dream. I cannot pursue my dream anymore. When? After 5 years? Pandemic is still here. When? People are asked questions. Our resolves weaken sometimes, and our perspectives dims. We are promised sufferings according to Apostle Peter. And he said that in his first letter, 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 12. Christians experience persecutions, Bill mentioned in the prayer. That if I'm not mistaken, it's a pastor, Bill, who was forced to sign the letter, not to preach in Jesus' name. I hope that preacher will remember Apostle Peter mentioning that it's rather to obey God rather than men. I cannot say that I'm not comparing myself to be in that pastor's shoes. I don't know. If you are in that situation, that person is in the brink of no choice. Maybe when he was asked to sign the letter of not preaching the name of Jesus, and then maybe the gun is pointing in his head. I'd rather to die than to sign that paper. Like what Apostle Peter said, it is rather to obey God rather than men. Everyone is different. But once you sign that letter, salvation is gone. Big time. It's like an heresy. Even though it's a piece of paper, it's a sign of declaration that you sign and give your declaration that you will follow them, whatever wants them you to do. Follow God, even though they will kill you. These people will kill us in this world, but we have soul. The soul will inherit the kingdom of God. The body will go to the ground, underneath, 6 feet below, but the soul will go to heaven with our Lord Jesus Christ. Even Peter mentioned this to all the Christians scattered in Asia Minor. They're experiencing persecutions and harassments in their faith in Pontus, Bithynia, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia. This is modern Turkey in our time. And he mentioned about trial of various kinds. So we are not like different from our brothers and sisters who live in the time of Apostle Peter in that time. Maybe we don't experience the same experience that they experienced in our time. But we experience a pandemic, a worldwide pandemic right now. It's a different kind of trials, you know, and situation. In John chapter 15, verse 20, and 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 12, Jesus said to his disciples here that remember the word that I said to you. A slave is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will persecute you as well. If they followed my word, they will follow yours also. Apostle Paul said to Timothy, his son in faith, indeed, all who want to live in a godly way in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. Remember, when the Lord Jesus Christ called Saul in the road to Damascus, the voice said to him, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" And Saul answered the voice, "Lord, who are you?" The voice answered him, "I am Jesus, the one whom you are persecuted." So Apostle Paul persecuting the Christians in Jerusalem, and the Lord Jesus Christ answered Paul, Apostle Saul in that time, "I am the one whom you are persecuted." See? This is what Jesus said to his disciples. Even James, the half-brother of Jesus, said in his letter, chapter 1, verse 2 to 4, "Consider it all joy," he said to the Christians in Jerusalem, the Messianic Jews, what they call. "The brothers and sisters, when you encounter various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces endurance. And let endurance have its perfect result, so that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing," he said. So when encouragement is absent from the life of a church, people will feel unloved, unimportant, useless, and forgotten. God knows his people are in need of grace-filled reminders. So he calls us to encourage each other every day until Jesus returns. Question is, how do we grow in being an encouragement to others? First, pray for God to make you an encourager. Ask God to give you a heart that loves others and creativity to know how to show it. Second, ask God to help you die to self-centeredness and grow in a desire to build others up. Third, study Barnabas, Apostle Paul's missionary partner in their first missionary journey, and ask God to make you like him. Barnabas was nicknamed the son of encouragement by the early church in Acts chapter 4, verse 36. He was the kind of person you wanted to have around as you were serving the Lord. He wasn't just a spiritual cheerleader, but he was a man of great conviction who wanted to see the church flourish and did all he could to make it happen. Fourth, make encouragement a daily discipline. For some of us, encouragement comes naturally. For others, not so much. Fifth, pray that God would create a culture of encouragement. In our local congregation here at Kiel, we found, and I saw, since I first came here way back in July 30 of 1984, and until today, I can still a lot of members of this congregation who has the ability to encourage one another. And they are there, encouraging brothers and sisters who are in trouble, financial difficulties, and some life challenges. They are there. They are not in the front, but they are in the back, that they are always watching and helping in a different way. And I still remember former members of this congregation who passed away, so many of them. I even remember until today that through their experiences and their testimonies and contribution to the place that we are now here in this new building since 1997, that because of their hard work, their perseverance, their ministries, everything that they contribute to the church, I want to name them, some of them. Joel's dad, Brother James Cormode, and Sister Charlie, they are now living in the States. They contribute a lot in this congregation. Brother Ben Manim Tim, who passed away with his family. The only remaining children is Sister Raquel Carlo and Nathaniel. So every time I saw them in the church, I always remember their parents in their bodies, you know, because it reminds me about the hard work and the ministry that they share to this congregation. There are so many brothers and sisters who encourage us personally to me. Nelson Dietz and his family always encouraged me during the time. I came to this country with a limited of English in 1994. And I'm so shy to communicate, because when the time when I came here, we are in the old sanctuary. This building is not here yet. So most of the members of the congregation are majority different background of people. Not a lot of Asian family is in the church. But nowadays it's different. The cycle was changed. I was so shy sometimes to express myself, you know, but like Arthur Chapman, he has a very strong spiritual motivation. He always assists me and encourages me all the time. Don't worry about your accent, Rico. We understand you. Don't worry about it. Just come and join us. So I was so thankful with Brother Arthur Chapman. He is there always, you know. So I just only mention here, it's not in my notes, but it's just, you know, cannot help myself to mention their names. It's been a while that we don't mention their names. But for me, mentioning their names is an honor to be with them in the time of the church is in situation of we don't know what will happen for the next 15 years, for the next 20 years. But now the fruit of their labor is now what we have now. So we don't know what will happen for the next 10 years to come after the pandemic, but the ministry of this congregation will continue. The Lord will bring workers in this congregation, and they will gather people who wish to serve the Lord. And the only thing that we can do is to just support one another. Lift each other up, you know. And let's create a culture of encouragement in our local congregation. Creating a church culture that glorifies God takes a long time. Lots of prayers and abundant grace. Now, this is my 26 years in this country as an immigrant. And I'm very proud to be a Filipino-Canadian. And I honestly say that God put me here, and Gloria sponsored me to come here, raising a family. And God gave me two children, Jed and Jem. And now God is using me in a different way. Let's encourage one another and put our hands in the table that give the best that we can give to the congregation. As what I already remember that now they said that in our Filipino community, they said like, let's change our attitude, you know, now in our mentality, that we are so lucky that we're here in Canada. They say, stop saying that. You should say, Canada is lucky because we're here. I think in my own opinion, I think it's true. Because a lot of people who left their hometown, home country, to move to a new country that they embrace, they are so talented people. And the country that they embrace them, accept them, these people will become an additional workforce to the country. No? Like us. We are so loyal. Even though we are Filipino, but we are so loyal to the country that we live in. Once we become a citizen, we will embrace the country that we accept. Even when I accept my citizenship way back in 1999, I pledged allegiance to the Queen of England. Like a lot of people say, why I give my allegiance to the Queen of England? Queen Elizabeth II. She's not my queen. But if you're Canadian, you will not get your citizenship if you will not pledge allegiance to the Queen Elizabeth II of England. That is how you get your citizenship. So that's why you become loyal to the country that you live in. But the first, foremost, important is we have to be loyal to the Lord Jesus Christ, the one who called us in faith, in salvation. I place my absolute reliance or in acceptance, give my life to God as He is my Lord and Savior. Third, we must do what Paul has asked us to do. Be a good comfort. Paul challenged the Corinthians to partake of the comfort that God offered to them in the midst of their trials, and also to let God use them as His instrument to help others. In 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 3 to 5, blessed be the God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort. He comforts us in all our affliction, so that we may be able to comfort those who are in any kind of affliction. Through the comfort we ourselves receive from God, for just as the sufferings of Christ overflow to us, so also through Christ our comfort overflows. In Psalms chapter 147, verse 3, says, He heals the brokenhearted and bandages their wounds. The old saying is absolutely true. Be kind to everyone who you meet, because everybody is carrying a heavy load. People all around, we are hurting, sometimes in ways that we know about, but more often in ways that we are totally unaware of. So we should not be judgmental. For instance, the person who may seem cool or unfriendly may actually be preoccupied with some terrible sorrow that it is tearing him apart. So let's go to those who are hurting. We don't have to be highly articulate to be used of God to help others. Or in fact, sometimes it isn't necessary to say anything at all. There is such a thing as the witness of presence, the witness of simply having cared enough to be there when someone is in need. Fourth, agree with each other and live in peace. Then the God of love and peace will be with you. Psalms 133 verse 1 says, Behold, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. James G. Merritt said, God is glorified, magnified, and satisfied when His children are unified. Apostle Paul said, be of one mind, live in peace. That doesn't mean we should agree about everything, but we should have in mind that we are part of one body through one baptism under one Lord, and we are called together because the Lord Jesus loves and accepts us, and we are called to serve Him and proclaim His good news. No matter what differences there are among us, that one thing binds us together. And our minds should be focused on that, working toward that as one. And that leads to Paul's last request, keep the peace. Even though he's just written a letter of high conflict, Paul says, keep the peace. Conflict will always be there, but don't make that too big. Don't make it the biggest thing among us. Keep the peace. Be kind and friendly, loving, patient, and self-controlled. This portrait of God both emphasizes how the Corinthians are to act toward each other and toward Paul as their apostle, and reminds readers of the reconciliation they have experienced with God through the love of Christ. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 14 to 19. The love of Christ controls us because we know that one person died for everyone, so all have died. He died for all so that those who live would not continue to live for themselves. He died for them and was raised from death so that they would live for him. From this time on, we don't think of anyone as the world thinks of people. It is true that in the past, we thought of Christ as the world thinks, but we don't think that way now. When anyone is in Christ, it is a whole new world. The old things are gone. Suddenly, everything is new. All this is from God. Through Christ, God made peace between himself and us. And God gave us the work of bringing people into peace with him, the ministry of reconciliation. I mean that God was in Christ making peace between the world and himself. In Christ, God did not hold people guilty for their sins. And he gave us this message of peace to tell people the word of reconciliation. In verse 12, Apostle Paul said to them, to the Corinthians, be warm and friendly. Give each other the special greeting of God's people. All of God's holy people here send you their greetings. David H. Stern, the writer of Jewish New Testament commentary, said, no one is sure exactly what a holy kiss was. Surely it was some sort of physical expression of warmth and love involving a hug, an embrace, or a kiss, touching, closeness, but entirely free of improper and unseemingly overtones. So in Israel, Arab men and Jewish men from Middle Eastern background often greet each other by kissing on both cheeks. In Romans chapter 16, verse 16, the Apostle Paul said to the Christians in Rome, greet one another with a holy kiss. All the churches of Christ send you greetings. So he mentioned about the name churches of Christ. It means there are so many churches around Roman Empire. It was mentioned the churches of Christ sent their greetings, you know, sent your greetings. These two greetings stress the unity of the church, local and universal. With a holy kiss, usually reserved for special reunions among family members, of formal greetings, extending such a public kiss to an entire group was a practice unique to the early church that signified their mutual acceptance as a family. It comes to my mind now, I remember I went to Tel Aviv in the district in the district of Jaffa 3 years ago when I attended Messianic congregation, and after their service I saw that they are practicing a holy kiss. They are touching their cheeks, you know, so many times, and I said that, wow, it's a nice feeling to see that Christians are doing this kind of spiritual recognition, you know, kissing themselves like a holy kiss. So this is what they do, the Messianic Christians or Messianic Jews, you know, when I witness it. So holy kiss express love, you know, without malice. This is a spiritual love that was Apostle Peter mentioned in his first letter in chapter 5, verse 14. Okay, next slide, Harani, please. He said, greet one another with a kiss of love. Peace to all of you who are in Christ. And as well as union and fellowship within the one family of God, it was a sign of mutual forgiveness and reconciliation that they sometimes exchanged before celebrating the Lord's Supper. It also demonstrated Christian liberty, transcending divisions based on gender, race, and status. For male and female, Jew and Greek, and slave and free, exchanged the kiss. Galatians chapter 3, verse 28. There is no Jew or Greek, slave or free, male and female, since you are all one in Christ Jesus. Greeting one another with a holy kiss is a tangible way to show love and fellowship in this community of believers who are still struggling to love one another and who are still learning how to be Christ's body in their world. So this exhortation is common in Apostle Paul's letters, as is the reminder that there are other Christians elsewhere who send their love. Apostle Paul was encouraging the Corinthians to be mindful of, attentive to one another whenever they came into the house of God, as well as whenever they might meet elsewhere. In like manner, we need to constantly work at the job of seeing that every member of the household of faith, as well as every visitor, is warmly received and made aware that he or she is a valued member of the congregation. May the Lord help us not to be careless at that point. No one should be overlooked or disregarded. Every person is precious in the sight of God. Give attention not only to those who are outgoing and personable and respond in kind, but also to those who are withdrawn, shy, or troubled. In fact, they probably need our attention more than anyone. Verse 13, full final salute. Give them salute to the Christians in Corinth. All the saints salute you. All of God's people send their greetings. Paul reminding that the Corinthians, that they were not alone, but were a larger part of fellowship made up of believers all over the world. So, brothers and sisters, I would like to conclude this in verse 14, a final prayer. So this final prayer by Paul is a prayer that it will give us a hope and wisdom that one day God will be with us when He comes back. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And this is the words of full of wisdom and encouragement to all of us. May the message of this will be a good encouragement to each one of us as we continue to worship God, as to finish this service. And may the love of God be with you all, brothers and sisters. In Jesus' name we pray and we say amen. Amen. God bless, brothers and sisters. Thank you, Rico. You're
welcome. So, I do want to clarify that the person who
signed the paper, she wasn't recanting her faith, but she was agreeing not to continue to evangelize and preach. She's actually a 21-year-old girl who has been a believer for, I believe, just a couple of years and was on an evangelistic trip to some neighboring villages that had not heard. So her colleague didn't, the other girl who was traveling, and she eventually was released, but she wound up spending another day in prison first. So they'd actually been in police custody for a full day before she signed. So she's got people who are going to be looking out for her and working with her a bit. But thank you for the encouragement. You know, it is good to have you in and to see you grow. You know, and I know you've been teaching a lot online, and it's good to have you in sharing with us. And this does wrap up our series on the messiness of faith and of this community. But gang, we are blessed to be part of this community, this with citizenship in heaven, people from every tribe and language and nation brought together. This is what we love about God's church. This is what we desire for Keele Street, right? That here in one of the world's most multicultural cities, we can reflect that nature of the Church of Christ. And so let's turn our attention to Him as we come to the table, because He's the one who unites us. He is the one who encourages us, as Rico just prayed, that His grace and love and fellowship would be with us.
to sow, my soul longeth after thee. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship thee. You alone are my strength, my shield. To you alone may my spirit yield. You alone are my
one point that we may not have gotten to yet about this holy kiss that he talks about. Now, Rico mentioned being at a Messianic congregation where they simply expressed their greetings to each other in kisses, okay? For the Greeks, that was not as common a salutation as among the Jews. Paul is actually encouraging a less extravagant culture, a less expressive culture, to adopt a custom from a more expressive culture. Why? Because it better represents the affection and love that God wants for his people. Now, many of us come from backgrounds that are a little less expressive than average. And so it's a bigger challenge for us. I should point out that the Greek church did really, they got into this and they made it a part of their worship. In fact, for hundreds of years, they made it a part of the worship service to gather together. Now, they did, you know, because they wanted it to make sure it was a holy kiss, women kissed women and men kissed men. But it was practiced in worship to build that sense of unity and allow that sense of expressiveness that was not as culturally understood for them as it was among the Jews, who had been greeting each other by kissing for, you know, thousands of years. For us, you know, God is molding us into a new culture. And it may mean that we loosen up a little, I guess, if you will, from where we've been in order to reflect the reality of who we are as this new community in Jesus Christ. So Rico will be leading us now in the communion.
I would like to read to you on the book of Matthew, Gospel of Matthew, chapter 26, verse 16, verse 26. As we accept the bread, the emblem of His body, and this is what the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 26, verse 26. While they were eating, Jesus took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to His disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is My body." Let's take the bread together as what Jesus commanded us to do. Then in verse 27, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks, and offered it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is My blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sin. I tell you, I will not drink of this fruit of the vine from now on until that day when I drink it anew with you in My Father's kingdom." Let's drink the emblem together as we remember the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ sacrificed on the cross. We will conclude the service. As we conclude the service this morning, I would like to read it to you the benediction of Jude in his letter to all of us. We unite in the Spirit to worship the Lord in the Spirit and in truth. He mentioned to all of us that to Him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you before His glorious presence without fault and with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, power and authority, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen. Go in peace, as what Jesus said to all of us. We'll see you again next Sunday. And God bless you all, brothers and sisters. Shalom, brothers and sisters.